Hello everyone, thank you for coming back and watching with us. Welcome to a Zoomed In Festival today. And we're holding a very special event this afternoon as part of Laura Mark's curated day on experiencing architecture. With a little help from our friends at NOWNESS, we're very, very excited to introduce Emile Rafael, the director. Where are you coming from today?
I'm in my house in London, Blackheath. Yeah, trying to not go crazy, but you know, so far so good.
Great. Well, yeah, I'm Luke O'Donovan, the festival director. And again, thanks to everyone that's tuning in. And if you're on YouTube right now, please do leave us comments. I'll try my best to feed a few of the questions in. But yeah, I mean, we've had a long schedule this week. Thanks to everyone that's stuck with us. We're going to have a bit more of a chilled session, I think, today. Just having a bit of a chat and some films. We've got some really good ones to see. So just before we get started, make sure you know, we're on all week. Look out for our program on zoomedinfestival.com, at zoomedinfestival on Instagram, at zoomedinfest on Twitter. And yes, keep an eye out for what we're doing. But yeah, I think let's get straight into it. So shall we introduce the first film and then have a bit of a chat about it after?
Yeah, and yeah, thank you so much for having me as well. Yeah, I've been watching some talks. And
actually, you know, should we tell us a bit about yourself first before we start?
Oh, I'm Emile, I'm a director. You know, I work quite a bit with NOWNESS, which I guess is our main chat today about. I also do music videos and commercials. I grew up in Prague, but I moved to London when I was 22. That's sort of the very short part of history.
Yeah. And the NOWNESS films, there's something, I mean, that's, I think, how a lot of the architectural community are aware of your work. Where did they start?
Well, so yeah, I was mainly doing music videos at the time. And yeah, the commissioners of NOWNESS got in touch with me, and the first film that we did together must have been about 4 or 5 years ago. It's a very long collaboration. And they asked me to do the René Redzepi film, you know, the Danish chef. And yeah, that went really well. We went to the Barbican, we kind of took him there and just followed him around. And I think already, like, it was kind of, there was already an architectural element there. Ever since, we kind of kept working together, and it's an amazing relationship that I have with them, and always appreciate when they ask me and commission me to do work, you know, because they just, it's such a great platform, and I think their quality control is just amazing.
Yeah, and that's something that's maybe, it gets lost on us a little bit in the, you know, the age of complete digital saturation. We're always seeing new stuff. To see someone that kind of takes a bit slower and is making sure there's a quality in everything that comes out is kind of really nice and refreshing in this day and age. But so what's the first film that we're going to be seeing today?
So the first one is part of the In Residence series that we do with NOWNESS. You know, it's sort of the inside of the homes of kind of the celebrated architects and designers and artists. This one is quite special because not only I was a big fan of David Ajay, you know, one of my favorite architects, but also of Sue Webster. And it's actually funny, you know, like my UK company, Agile Films, we're in Redchurch Street, and like every time I went there, you know, I just noticed this, the Dirty House, you know, the first kind of collaboration between them two. And I always thought like, oh, this would be a great in-residence piece. But then by the time kind of everything, we were kind of talking about it, she acquired this new property and people started telling me like, oh, she's gonna live in this mole man's house, you know? And I just remember being so intrigued by the whole story of it. And not only loving her art, but also it just was like everything was there, all the elements were there. And I'd be really upset if NOWNESS for some reason commissioned another director to do it. So yeah, I'm glad I did this one. So yeah.
Okay, great. Well, let's get into it then. So both turn off our video and microphone, and I'll start sharing it.
I tried to buy this building for like years. And then all of a sudden it appeared in auction, and there was a newspaper article saying, no one wants to buy Moleman's house. I was like, hang on a minute, I've been trying to buy this house for years.
So yeah, again, thanks for sharing that with us, and thank you to Nowness as well for giving us permissions on this. Yeah, it's a great film. Let us know in the YouTube comments if we're working on the technical side. And yeah, I think the first, I mean, really striking thing about this that I've not really kind of had in another architectural film is the music, you know, kind of those really pulsating guitars right from the get-go that really grabs your attention. So do you want to say a little bit about the thought process behind that?
Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah, music is really important in these because, you know, we're kind of trying to approach them from a very, like, almost storytelling, cinematic point of view. And I think a lot of times, yeah, like, the music is there to enhance, like, the feeling of the personality of the space, you know, of the house itself. So, yeah, and I think with this one, you know, because Sue is so punk in a way, you know, and everything she does is really kind of edgy and cool. And I just don't know, it just really fitted her, you know, even though, you know, because the series is so much based on architects, you know, well, obviously on everyone, but like a lot of them are architects. And a lot of times the music was a bit calmer, but for this one, yeah, I just thought, you know, she needs some sort of like, we need to capture her personality and kind of we need something like that. And I was actually listening to the Dead Man soundtrack, and I thought that this is the, like, we should do something like that, you know. And actually I asked a guy, you know, Oscar, who's, you know, did this amazing music, he just like played the guitar while seeing the film, so it's like live guitar without any editing. So yeah, I think that's why it's kind of, yeah, fit quite well with it.
Nice, yeah. I mean, Sue dropped some kind of great gems in there. Like, I love a quote about, oh, I've just been trying to buy this house, like, really casually. That's kind of where we all want to be in life, where we're casually house hunting like that. That's great. But I think, yeah, part of what sets apart the films you do from a lot of the, I guess, more commercial stuff that we see in architecture a lot is that you're telling these stories, and it's not so much about the buildings themselves, but more about kind of the lives that buildings enable and the things that take place within buildings and the people behind them. But within this particular project, it's quite complex because, you know, like I said, Sue said, you've got the three stories. You've got a story about Sue, you've got a story about the Mole Man, you've got a story about original building, you've got David Adjaye's intervention. So how did you kind of approach condensing that down into a five minute video? You know, how did you decide where you want to put your focus?
Well, yeah, I mean, this was a hard one. I mean, because there was so much of it, and you know, what we do is, like, usually we have this kind of interview conversation for like an hour and a half, you know, and then we get this like really long transcript, and that's where we, you know, so much of the films are done in the edit in a way, and we basically go through the transcript and then we just kind of edit it and try to kind of tell a story there. Yeah, this one was really hard because, you know, there's David Adjaye, there's Sue, and then there's Moma, and like all of them, like all three could be its own film, you know? So yeah, to be honest, it was like a lot of trial and error and like driving my editors crazy and going back and forth. And then sometimes being like, oh, this is not just about the Moma, and this is now just about Sue, you know? It's like, Yeah, so it was a lot of wrestling, but hopefully we have a good balance. And that's the thing, most of these in residence films are 3 minutes actually. So this one, like even at five, felt short somehow, you know. But yeah, we had to stop there.
Yeah, I mean, I feel seeing it, even it's one house and you spent 5 minutes. I don't feel like I've even seen the whole house. I'm looking. I feel like I've kind of, yeah, I've quite an intimate experience of that one room with Sue, but everything else is just, you know, a little detail here, a little detail there. And you're kind of, I guess it's almost like you're revealing the house slowly throughout the film. And that's kind of part of how you, I guess, create the architectural story as well.
Yeah, I guess I think, you know, the interview is quite important in the beginning because it kind of gives me a sense how to film the house, you know, and how to transmit that energy of the person and the way and the thought that went into the house and the way they interact with it as well. So I think like a lot of times I kind of go around the house and just think like, you know, yeah, and what's the kind of room that you would, you know, you would show first and then, and where they spend most of their time as well. And I think like what's really important as well, like just the use of light, you know, so we kind of, you know, I carefully kind of see at what time of the day it gets the best light, you know, as well. So that kind of dictates a little bit how you shoot and yeah, at what point you show, you know, because I guess you need like serious also light consistency through the whole thing.
Yeah, sure. How much do you style the houses as well? So you're quite kind of natural with, you know, letting the people be themselves and, you know, using the ambient light. But a thing with all these architectural films, everything always looks really tidy. Is there a lot of stage management behind that, or do people just live like this?
I think people actually clean them up pretty well before we come in. I mean, I don't know, maybe some of them live that neatly, but probably obviously not since it's their houses. So yeah, to be honest, very little, you know, like sometimes you have a shot and you just like a little bit adjust an object and just to kind of keep the symmetry or the composition. But I think a lot of times it is pretty, like, you know, been like organized quite well by the people. But I remember like actually meeting Sue, and she was the one that said, you know, I'm not going to like make my bed. I'd never make my bed. So why would I do that for this? You know, so it's like, let's put some, you know, reality into it as well. So that's why actually, you know, I think this is the only in residence film that has an unmade bed. Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, yeah, you really kind of do see a bit of a personality through it. I mean, so how much of it do you feel is that collaboration between you and the, you know, the architect or the resident of these buildings you're filming? And have there been times where it's been a lot, I guess Sue, you know, it's come off really well with her. Have there been times where you've had more difficult characters and you've had to kind of negotiate the direction a bit more?
Yeah, I mean, I think the understanding from the very beginning is that, you know, it is very much sort of our film, and we're not there, you know, because we're not getting much, you know, we're not really getting out of it. We're not there to really promote the architectural practice or the, you know, the art. You know, obviously it happens naturally, but yeah, I think in a lot of ways we sort of the understanding is that, you know, we don't send the questions ahead. Like, I like to have it as a conversation, you know, the interview part is just so important that, you know, it's not prepared, it's not dry. It's like really bring out the person. Yeah, I mean, most of, like, I would say like 90%, 95% of the time, you know, they really go with it, you know, and they really trust it, and they don't see the cuts, you know. They, like, after we filmed it, nobody sees it, nobody has any say in it. So yeah, I don't think of one person that kind of insisted on having the questions beforehand and insisted on different angles, and then they had this assistant with us the whole time, and the assistant was moving stuff around for us and stuff. And yeah, and that, I think that's, for, you know, that this is my least favorite one, because, you know, there's just not the, because I think like a lot of times we with interior films or architectural films, they can really feel lifeless, you know, because it's architecture, you know, and because a lot of times there's no people in the frames. I think you really need somehow to make them alive, you know, and make them kind of give them a feeling, you know, give them a sense of movement, sense of kind of the way you interact with the house. So I think it's important that it's kind of like it's approached from my perspective and how I see the house, especially after talking to them. And yeah, so I don't even remember what your question is anymore. But yeah.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's almost, I guess, why they bring you into these things, because, you know, an architect could produce a film themselves, I'm sure, about kind of the technical aspects of what a building is, you know, how it stands up, what it's made out of, but it takes something a bit more, a different kind of intelligence to interpret the buildings in the way you have. And kind of, I guess when we were speaking on the phone a couple of weeks ago before this conversation, and saying that you didn't have kind of the that formal architectural knowledge, but I challenged you on that, in that I think we all have that architectural knowledge from using buildings all the time, from, you know, experiencing buildings, having our own stories of buildings, and that's, do you think that kind of knowledge is just as valid as the formal architectural knowledge?
I think so. I mean, I think the funny thing about me is that, yeah, like I until I started doing these films, or until I met my wife, actually, I never actually thought about architecture really. And it's funny because she works in architecture, and all her family are in, you know, her brother runs an architectural practice called Almanac. So shout out to him. But yeah, and it's funny, like when I met her, and it's kind of coincided a little bit with me being asked these completely kind of separately to be asked to be doing these films. And it's since then, and seeing, you know, her, that side of her family, the way they think about architecture, and also doing these films. Yeah, I think obviously there is more thought going into it, but yeah, I don't know. It's kind of like, I almost feel like it's almost good for me not to have architectural knowledge, to be honest. I don't know. I feel like I almost feel better that I don't put so much emphasis on, you know, the way something's been built, you know, and the way they got their planning permission, or, you know, the way the beams are connected together or something. You know, I'm more interested in the personality and the person inhabiting the house, and then the story of the house itself. And I think that makes more for a compelling watch rather than kind of a dry architectural film. I don't know.
I think there's a conversation to be had about what the purpose of these films are. So I guess a lot of the more commercial stuff, you can talk about an informative purpose. You know, it kind of serves well kind of that mission of educating people and, you know, promoting an architectural practice within the industry where people are going to understand and engage with that. But maybe I think the kind of stuff you do is for a different audience. I mean, you have, the television architecture shows and so on. And I don't know, what do you think about kind of the space you'd like your work to live in, and the kind of audience you think that it's, I guess, worthwhile to be reaching with architectural concept? I mean, do you think kind of, would you ever want to work on a grand designs type show? Would you kind of think this could be something that's, you know, mainstream entertainment? Or do you think actually you prefer it being a more niche thing? Where do you kind of think architectural video content can sit in the future culture?
Yeah, good question. I mean, probably not grand designs. I don't know. Yeah, I feel like, I think the way, yeah, the things like, I think the way I approach these films is very for much a filmmaking point of view, in terms of like, making something that is almost like a short film, like a documentary, you know? And so, and even though I think, you know, these films are very much enjoyed by, you know, architects and people working there, but they're also quite accessible to people that are not necessarily, you know, very technically interested in architecture. So, yeah, I don't know. I think it's like a really good balance as a result, you know. I think, I don't know where I wanted to live. I don't know. I feel like, you know, it's kind of interesting. It's to promote this interest in architecture. And I think obviously, with this series, obviously a lot of these houses are incredibly, you know, some of them are even like more like statements of design rather than like a comfortable living situation, you know? So sometimes they do feel like kind of almost unattainable, you know, but I feel like, yeah, the films are kind of striking the balance to being like, well, this is actually, you know, it's kind of like in this place of like being a statement and being like sort of a piece, like almost an art perspective to architecture, and being sort of somebody's living room, you know? I don't know. I think hopefully everyone really enjoys it, in terms of the audience, really. And kind of, I think I try so hard to do it, you know, with this kind of documentary approach to it.
I think is that, I guess also a limitation you have is that with these kind of shoots, you know, you're with the project for just, I don't know, I mean, how long are you with the project? Maybe you're there shooting for a day, maybe break down a little bit, could you, how that process works from beginning to end?
So usually we start with, we go there, you obviously, you know, get the sort of the information, you know, who usually Nowness are the ones that think of people, you know, and think of who to engage, and they engage with the architects themselves, and then they send me the information, you know, and usually it's always like, wow, this guy, yeah, that's great, you know, or this architect or this practice or something. And then basically we go there for a day to scout. I mean, not for a day, for like an hour. And we kind of see the place and hopefully meet the person. And yeah, then the filming is usually in one day. Unless there was a few times where it was raining, you know, and the light wasn't great. So we had to come back, which was a bit tricky. But then, yeah, usually it's a day, you know, it's like an interview in the morning and then we film the whole thing. And then I think the longest part of it is editing, you know, is kind of trying to find that story and trying to piece together the interview. And then obviously Nowness has a very editorial approach to the whole thing. So there's a lot of discussion afterwards in the edit of how we shape it and what to do, you know, there. So yeah, that's kind of, I would say, yeah, the whole thing takes about 3 weeks maybe or so.
So yeah, and I think, I mean, it must be quite challenging by the fact that, you know, within a space of 3 weeks, Moulman House has, you know, a story worth decades. And I guess there's kind of limitations on how much of that story you can tell. And do you think, you know, in the future it's something you could do, or, you know, there's a space for more of this to happen within, you know, within kind of a business of more of these form architectural stories about kind of, you know, a project from start to completion, or, you know, more not specifically about an individual project, maybe even about kind of a movement or a school of thought, an idea. Is there kind of a space, do you think, for more of that kind of long form content over several years?
Maybe, yeah, I think so. You know, especially, you know, with interesting buildings, I have a lot of story behind them, as you say, you know, it's like, and I think as people hopefully get more interested in, you know, architecture, and I think, you know, this is quite nicely kind of discussed in the Frank Gehry films, like how quickly people forget that architecture is an art form, you know, and I feel like once hopefully more people realize it, and these films kind of drive it forward as a sort of more of a, you know, more of like, this is how to improve your house. So, you know, obviously there's plenty of inspiration there, how to like maybe, you know, design some spaces and stuff. I think, yeah, it's more like, you know, these are the people that kind of at the forefront, and this is how they think about living space and what is, you know, what is a home really, you know, which is one of the last questions I asked them, you know, what kind of makes a home for you? And even though obviously a lot of their work is, I don't know if I'm answering your question, but yeah, I mean, I think so. Yeah, I think like, you know, I think there is a lot of space for architectural films, you know, in general, and documentaries about them, and kind of putting more and more out there about just what goes into making them and what the history of the buildings and how they, you know, everyone thinks about them when making them.
Okay, great. Well, I think that leads us quite nicely into the next film that you're showing with us today. So while I load that up, would you like to give a little bit of an introduction for what we're in for next?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, Frank Gehry needs no introduction in a way. Yeah, I mean, this was an amazing one, because obviously when I first heard about it, they said, oh, do you wanna, you know, make a film about the foundation Louis Vuitton and interview Frank Gehry, you know, and yeah, a lot went into it. But again, like, I feel like it went so well because he's an amazing, you know, you kind of, with people like that, you know, you kind of obviously see a lot of press and you kind of construct your image of them, and you wonder, you know, how much is it, you know, PR and how much is it like, you know, real. But then with him, like, it's like meeting a person like that, like that, that makes the whole film really, because his energy is so big, and you know, and thoughts he puts into buildings are so amazing. So yeah, this one is a separate of the In Resin series. It was mostly about this. So obviously it's not a living space, but it's more of a public space. But yeah.
Are you still in touch with Frank?
No, I'm not. I wish I was. I mean, because it was one of the most inspirational conversations I had with someone. And I was actually, you know, I heard that he liked the film. And there was a time when I thought like, oh, I'm, you know, with him, I could make a longer form documentary, actually. But maybe I could talk to him about it.
Yeah, I mean, he's not really the kind of guy you can slide in with DMs, is he? He's a bit harder to get hold of.
Yeah, I think he has a bit of a team, you know, to to reach. Yeah, but yeah. So and you didn't, you know, we didn't exchange numbers or anything at the end, unfortunately.
Okay, cool. Well, let's get on to the film then.
Cool.
If you write your signature and I write my signature, they look different. So my aesthetic is mine and yours is yours. So that, I can't help it. The great works of architecture express feeling. When you
Well, yeah, I mean, thanks for sharing that with us. I've watched that so many times. It still makes me smile every time I watch it. I mean,
oh, good.
That's kind of one of the things, you know, getting into, you know, my own career as architectural photographer, that kind of stuff's always been a constant reference point to me. So, yeah, thanks to you and to Nowness for sharing it with us. Maybe going back a little bit to what we were talking about a few minutes ago, you can just tell from, you know, the way Frank talks, kind of you know, how much of an inspirational character he is and how much of an inspirational building it is. Did you feel that energy when you, I mean, what was kind of a mood, you know, what music were you playing on set? You know, what did you feel the energy that comes across in that film, or is that kind of something that you bring in the editing room?
Yeah, I mean, well, obviously there was like the energy leading up to the film, filming it was a mostly nervous energy because, you know, there was a lot of talk kind of, you know, Frank, I call him Frank now, you know, a lot of people saying like, actually, you know, and there was actually a bit of a kind of chat with his, I think, PR team and stuff like that, as I saying, actually, you know, he's kind of, you know, he's done a lot of interviews, you know, and he's actually known for stopping the interviews, like in the first 5-10 minutes, you know, because he sort of says, you know, I've talked about this before, you know, I don't really allow myself to get nervous in these instances, just because, you know, and I kind of treat them as, you know, try to treat them as normal people, because otherwise I feel like I will show and I will be a bit too kind of, you know, nervous about the whole thing and not ask the right things. But then when he came, you know, and literally in the first 10, 15 minutes, he just started talking about things and it just kind of flowed. And I think a lot of times, you know, what he said was, especially with the building, was the sense of movement, you know, and the sense of, you know, a building giving you a feeling, obviously, and it being, you know, kind of an expression of something. And so I guess, yeah, that really informed the way we filmed it. You know, when Nowness stuff is mostly very locked up frames, you know, very subtle movement, this was all about movement and kind of discovering those shapes and going into the museum itself, obviously, and showing art and the art that is moving as well. So it's kind of just, yeah, just encompassing everything he said. And yeah, so I did think a lot about that, you know, and I did, and all, and yeah, the music, yeah, I felt like it should be epic because it's such an epic building. It's kind of, you know, even, yeah, being there and having filmed it, I feel like I still, you know, need to go back to experience it again, because it does give you such a feeling, you know.
So I'm trying as well to, as well as the conversation, keep one eye on the YouTube comments, because thanks to everyone that's tuning in and keeps leaving comments. So got Fantastique saying, when's the Netflix series?
Oh yeah, well, I don't know, I'm still waiting for that call, but yeah, hopefully soon. I mean, obviously Netflix did do the chef's one, so I think the architect one is should be a good one.
Yeah, and we got India Bradshaw, one of your collaborators, in there as well. So hi.
Oh
hi,
yeah.
But yeah, I mean, yeah, going back to what we were talking about a second ago. So I think I've been fortunate as well, fortunate enough to visit the Fondation Louis Vuitton myself, and I think like a really big part of it. So actually, I'd like to pull out a little something from a book I have about the really beautifully put together book I have about the building. So we have these fantastic photographs by Iwan Bon. And a lot of what is in that is you know, it's about, and you see this a lot in more of a kind of landmark architecture, but it's not just about the building itself, it's about where it's designed, it's about the approach. And you know, you have the park next to it, you have, you know, the lines of the trees and stuff. But in your film, you kind of approach that in reverse, maybe. So you start with an interior shot, and then you're gradually coming out and kind of, that crescendo of a view over Paris from the top floor. So what was kind of the thinking behind flipping that round in that way?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I think the thinking was to start sort of close up and start, because the building is so vast and it's so kind of, you almost like, even when you see it from far away, you're still trying to kind of make sense of it, you know, and because he's talking about sort of like the inspiration about it, it's almost kind of like I wanted it to be almost feel like a scrapbook of, you know, almost like, you know, the way he thinks, you know, because that's why there's all that sort of VHS stuff as well. It's almost like kind of his inspiration and his thought process of the building itself and how he's kind of constructing in his head. So, you know, we start with the model, and then we go to the sketch, you know, and we just keep building and building on top of that. And then we keep building on the shots, and then we kind of go further and further and wider and wider. Yeah, that was kind of the idea. And yeah, like India is my amazing producer. So yeah, she does a lot of work with me, and a lot of times very thanklessly doing like a lot of, we did the Sue Webster film together, and she managed to do 3 days of shoot on that one. So yeah, hi India.
Right, yeah. I think, yeah, I mean, something that's a little bit, you know, I find quite fascinating about your work, which is maybe something where we have a bit of a creative difference, is, you know, something that's very popular within architectural photography, and, you know, it's a big part of my practice, is that idea of context. And, you know, especially with, you know, big landmark buildings like this, I probably wouldn't photograph it in a way comparable to with how you filmed it. I'd be more inclined to kind of photograph it as part of that townscape, photograph kind of the wide shots of the experience of, you know, approaching it and looking at how it fits in that environment. Whereas I feel your videos are more approaching kind of a building itself as a destination. So I wanted to kind of think, again, it's similar to the Sue Webster film, where you've got all these different stories and you're kind of having to just pull out one that fits in this short video. So what made you kind of choose that you're focusing on that story of a destination rather than thinking about the outside? And also, is that in other projects something you're interested in, more of the idea of architecture, not in the form of individual buildings and projects, but architecture in the form of cities and how it all fits together? Is that something you thought about capturing on film in some way?
Yeah, it's a good question. I'm not sure like I do it consciously, in all honesty, you know, just how the building fits. And obviously it's a very important aspect of it, and just how the building fits with its surroundings, you know, because a lot of times there is that kind of thing with modern architecture where it's like an amazing, like, you know, even though the building is amazing, but it's kind of, it's like slotted between these, you know, historical buildings, and sometimes the like two of them just like are so jarring, but sometimes they fit very well together. And actually it's funny, because that's how I feel like we connected with Frank Gehry, is that we started talking about the Dancing House in Prague, and it's a building that really has people divided, you know, because it's a really modern looking like building that's kind of connected to these really like old buildings, and in Prague people are either loving it or absolutely hating it. And yeah, and so we started talking about that, you know, and it just reminds me that's how we kind of started the conversation. But yeah, I mean, I think for me, when I do these films, it's almost like the building is the character, right? It's kind of the almost like a personality as well. And I try to kind of, even the way I do the angles, you know, sometimes like it's like a low angle and the building is very kind of imposing. And yeah, and a lot of times, yeah, just I guess I'm kind of like very tunnel vision on the building. But I don't know, maybe I should do wider shots of it, how it fits. The Louis Vuitton one is almost like among the forest, right? And then like it's also connected to by a road on the other side, but there's not much else around it, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of, yeah, labeled as a Paris institution, but it's a bit of a way out from the city.
Yeah.
But I mean, I guess if Nowness gave you a call tomorrow and said, or obviously after the lockdown, said, we want you to go out and make a film about Paris, how would you approach that?
Yeah, well then I guess you take Paris as a sort of like as a character as well. And then yeah, you kind of you find ways to show that personality. But I mean, I think, you know, yeah, if it was a project about a series of buildings, or you know, because it is important just how a building fits in with the surroundings and how well the architect thought about it, you know, like how he approached like the buildings nearby and the landscape. And a lot of times, I guess a lot of the residence house, they're almost like almost secluded, you know, a lot of them have sort of a feeling, they either like outside look very normal and then you go in and they're like these incredible places, or yeah, they're kind of slightly concealed. I guess that's why there isn't like much kind of what's around it, I guess. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm having another look through the YouTube comments. So yeah, shout out to Manuel, a friend of Zoomed In. Check out the Architecture Film Festival. He says, I like the way the video image sequence is constructed. A bit allegory. Was this intentional?
I don't think so. No, I haven't thought about that, to be honest. I mean, the stuff, is it about the Frank Gehry or about the In Residence?
Well, about the Frank Gehry film, is it the way that kind of, you know, how you sequence the images, how you kind of flick between the shots, is that inspired by, I guess, the sporadic nature of kind of the forms of his architecture to some extent?
I guess so. I remember the whole thing was kind of how to, yeah, because I guess, you know, there's the building, there's the outside of it, then there's the art that's inside, you know, and then it's this whole context of movement and Frank talking about his ideas and kind of, you know, the way he thought about the building. So there was a lot of like thinking, how can we make it flow? How do we like, you know, how do we show the building and then art and then go back to the building and for some way for it to feel like part of the same thing, because it was kind of weird. Like the first versions, I think was really weird. Like you're outside of the building or it's architectural, but then suddenly you're just looking at art, you know? So there was kind of, I think like, for example, the VHS stuff helped with that because you're kind of like switching between this kind of really degraded footage and then to like some really like, you know, like high def stuff that it's kind of like, it did feel almost kind of dreamlike. And then back to, yeah, I think, you know, there was a lot of back and forth and a lot of like about the flow, basically. You just needed to have a sense of movement as much as, you know, what he's talking about and how his building has a sense of flow. Yeah.
And is it, I mean, I guess when you're dealing with these it's kind of quite abstract concepts, is it a challenge communicating that? Actually, maybe kind of just reframe that. So thinking about how some of the other filmmakers we had on today are more, they work in a kind of more individual way, but you coming from more of a cinema background, you're, I guess, working with a team on a lot of these shoots. And how do you kind of communicate those quite abstract ideas and get everyone kind of aligned in the same vision?
Well, so for example, you know, with in residence series, actually, we did have in the very beginning, we kind of almost established this sense of these like rules with Nowness. Like I was looking at our first email chain about it. It's like we thought, you know, and it really helps the people working with you, I think, to kind of say, here are our limitations, you know, and we were quite strict. We were like saying, no kind of, you know, no gimmicky stuff, you know, no rack focus. There's a lot of stuff that you do to kind of, I feel like to do, you know, you kind of, the shot is not that interesting and a bit boring. And then you find ways to somehow give it life, you know, and so rack focus, we said like no slow motion. Some of these we have broken. Some of these
That's what rules are for.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, maybe like one per film or something. Yeah, and then we thought like, oh, you know, the interviews should be like interestingly composed. You know, it shouldn't be just like a talking head with like a lot of out of focus. You know, everything's quite sharp. Everything's about composition. So yeah, I think, and also, I mean, historically, I actually did the films with the cinematographer. But to be honest, the last five or so, I did the cinematography myself just because, yeah, I kind of, there's still a team, you know, there's a camera team to kind of move the camera around, because it's generally quite, you know, heavy and there's still a lot of equipment involved and different lenses, but yeah, I kind of frame myself, to be honest, you know, and kind of just, you know, do the exposure myself and everything, just like looking at where the light travels. So it's still quite a small team, but it would say like five people, yeah.
Including. I think, yeah, I mean, it can be quite challenging, especially, I mean, we're all the internet generation and kind of, I mean, this festival was a perfect example. Like this week, you know, I've been running a press campaign with a lot of help from, shout out Luke Neve at Neve Communication. So Neve Agency for helping with communications. But yeah, a press campaign, social media campaign, a print sale, events, making a website, all of that. And I think we're kind of, what the internet has enabled is we're all kind of used to doing everything ourselves and kind of, I mean, I know that you do, you know, of course you got your film work, but you also, you know, your painting work. Before we went on air, we were talking about like our comparing simps and stuff. You know, you're someone that does a lot of different things, has these different skills. And as a creative practitioner, how do you know kind of when to take on something yourself or when to like delegate and collaborate?
Yeah, very good question. I mean, I think, you know, it depends on the scale of the project and yeah, just kind of how much you kind of, how much support you need, I guess. I think it's interesting. Yeah, I mean, filmmaking can be very frustrating because, you know, it's almost like, I almost feel like it's painting. But then you have like, sometimes you have like 50 people holding the brush and then you have to kind of like tell them a vague direction to go to in a way, you know. And in that sense, when the project is quite big, you know, and you do need a lot of crew and because you know, just the nature of the job, you kind of, at that point, I think you progressively learn to kind of let go a lot of the control and kind of just tell them like, in more like abstract ways, like this is the feeling I'm going for, or this is the type of stuff that you want. And in that way, you kind of learn how to get the best out of your team, you know? But then for projects like Nowness, you know, because I mean, the stuff like with this stuff, you know, it's because it's an interview, you know, and it's because it's a person's home, you kind of have to keep it minimal in a way. And you kind of don't want to be in the way too much. And also having a film crew in your house is the most stressful thing. And especially if you have like expensive art around and stuff like that, you know, so you try your best to minimize it. And I think, yeah, I think, you know, I kind of learned to kind of do both, you know, and try to kind of realize, but there is a point where sometimes you might have too many people or sometimes you might not have enough. Yeah, it just comes with, you just really look at the project and think like, do I really need someone to help me here or can I do it myself? Yeah.
So are you kind of the mindset where, are you more you'd bring in people to help if you need it or are you kind of someone you like to, you know, you I guess it's, you can bring in people to help because you're unable to do something, or you can bring people to do something that is there a conflict because you want to do everything sometimes, but actually bringing in another person who's more like a specialist in that can kind of enhance things, even though it feels like, you know, you've got that internal struggle of you don't want to give up your own creative control on everything. But yeah, actually sometimes it's the better way to fulfill the vision is to involve other people.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's definitely some people I would never not have, you know, for example, editors, you know, you do need that person. Like for me, it's really important that there is a person that takes your footage and takes your interview and you kind of collaborate, but there's someone who hasn't been on set, hasn't really watched all the, you know, every particular shot and like is, you know, not just like somebody who, you know, runs the software, but also somebody who's like, is an editorial kind of voice that's kind of telling you, well, this is stuff we should cut, this is stuff we should bring back in. And it's like, and I think it's important, you know, it's a really, because yeah, as you say, like in these days, it's almost like somebody can learn to do everything, you know. In a way, directors should almost feel like know quite a lot, you know, you do know about cameras and lenses and how to edit, and even sometimes you can even teach yourself how to color grade and all these things, but there is like a certain science to a lot of these things that you do kind of shouldn't really skim on, I feel like. So I think I'm always leaning to, I'd rather have people, you know, help me out. And it's also really fun to work with people, you know. But for example, with Frank Gehry, like most of it was shot on Steadicam, and that was great. Like, for example, the Steadicam operator is actually somebody who is, you know, a quite specific person, like knows how to work that equipment, and you are then just like telling him like, well, start here and then end up there. But like, you know that there'll be a certain creativity involved how they get to that place, you know. So yeah, collaboration is usually fun.
Right. And is it, I guess, do you maybe approach that question differently between self-assigned work and commissioned work?
I think so, yeah. I mean, also, like, it depends on how much of a... Yeah, for example, there's films that are almost feel like they're just personal projects, you know, which these films are. But there's also, like, you know, commercials and branded commissions where you kind of want to kind of almost, like, have these levels of people and, yeah, kind of almost... you know, because the quality control is huge, but it's also like you kind of want to protect yourself from having a lot of amazing team around you. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. And I mean, just on that note, what other things are you working on kind of besides the work you're commissioned for? What other ideas are you kind of, I guess now is kind of a idea incubator period, isn't it, while we're all stuck at home?
Yeah, I mean, obviously a strange time for everyone. I'm doing a lot of painting. There's time for that. I'm trying to write a TV show and kind of develop that. And this is a perfect time to kind of sit down and do that. And yeah, there's a documentary idea floating around as well. But obviously, I don't know. I'm talking to a lot of creative people and they're finding that in this time, even though it feels like you should be doing a lot of stuff and this is a perfect time to incubate, like it's actually quite hard to get in the creative flow because every day you're either like completely zen or you're thinking the world is about to end, you know?
Yeah. And Emile, are there, I guess, sorry, I lost my train of thought there. The ideas that you said, kind of you got this idea for a TV series, you got this idea for a documentary. Are there things you're allowed to tell us about, or is that kind of tune into the next episode?
Yeah, I mean, it's still early on. I guess I kind of quite early in the projects. I think maybe next time. Next time we'll next year I'll be hopefully on the next stage of development, so we can.
great. Okay, cool. Well, I'll just flick to a couple of the YouTube questions then to finish us off nicely. So Clara Lisa is actually. I was going to ask this as well, maybe. Of all the houses that you filmed in, which one would you want to live in?
To be honest, none of them. I don't know. I think with a lot of them that I saw, a lot of times, and because I saw so many, like there's so many solutions to how you can design your own house. It kind of made, none of them felt comfortable enough for me or like fitting my personality. I have a house like in mine now that I'd love to build, and it's all like one floor. I really hate stairs. I realized through the whole thing, like I really hate stairs. not just because you drag your equipment around, but like I just also, whenever you live somewhere with stairs, it's always like you seem to always forget something on a different floor, which is a really controversial thing to say, but I think my house is one level. It has a central atrium where I can have like plants growing, and I go around that and I can go from one room to another, and it has like a glass front window, like sort of a Californian house.
Don't tell us anymore. Save it for when you get bored enough to make an in-residence of your own house.
Yes.
We want to see it on video. Okay, another one. So Sergio Lopez, hi to you again. He's been tuning into a lot of our events. Hi to Tyrone as well, Ben Sage, all these guys. Sergio's asking, where else would you like, is there kind of one building in the world where you want to have that experience of shooting it? Or actually, to kind of reframe that question again, would you choose your kind of dream shoot based on the building, or would you actually be more kind of inclined to, there's a person that you want to film and then the building comes secondary to that?
I think you're right. Like, I think it's the person, you know, it's the architect and it's the process that goes into it. Like, I think that excites me much more than the building. Like for somebody, and there's so many amazing people, I'd love to actually do something with David Ajay, you know, like one of his, you know, public spaces or even his house. And also like Heather Wick seems to be a really fascinating person. Like, yeah, I'd love to film some stuff with him. Yeah, that'd be great. You know, just so many amazing architects to kind of at the forefront that would be interesting to do stuff with. Yeah.
If you're watching, then if you're out there, Mr. Heather Wick or Mr. Ajay, get on the phone.
Yeah. Yeah, please. And Netflix, if anybody from Netflix is watching as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Fantastic. Well, everyone's kind of saying thank you to everyone in the comments, you know, saying we've got to do a part two sometime. You know, they love your work. And thank you to you. And thank you to Nowness as well for kind of giving us permission for this. But thanks so much for sharing a little bit of insight into the work that you do. I think we could go on for ages, but we've just passed the hour mark, so I'll keep this digestible because we've got plenty more on. So zoomedinfestival.com is where you need to be looking. Got our schedule, so we've got one more event today at 7 p.m. back with our guest curator for the day, Laura Mark. Then tomorrow as well, we have loads of stuff on. We're just confirming the last few details for that, but I'm really excited. I'm co-curating that with a friend of mine, Francisco Ibanez. Yeah, so have a look on there. I'm just going to share our website with you guys. 1 second. So I've been going on about this the whole festival, but I think it's worth talking about because it is something that's very, very important. Excuse me a second while I share my screen. Yes, can you see the website there? Okay. Looking good. So yeah, on our website, we've got our schedule for the rest of the day. So no touching, please, panel talk at the end of the day and loads of great stuff on tomorrow. We're also fundraising throughout the festival for the Trussell Trust, which support food banks throughout the UK. It's really important we support them. And we have a print sale. So we've got some of the leading architectural photographers in the world have really generously contributed to this to give you really affordable prints, which are available for sale. And Emile, do you want to kind of talk us through one or two of your picks from a selection?
Oh yeah, I mean, there's just so many amazing ones actually. I'm going to order some. The one of them I'm definitely getting, which is the, where is it? Just literally had it, the one of the Peckham waiting room.
Edmund Summer at the bottom, yeah, but I'll limit it. We have our affordable print sale for, you know, we appreciate kind of times are a little bit tough and, you know, collecting art is something that is very exclusive. So we have our affordable sale with prices starting from £25, and we have a lot of artists in there who are normally selling prints for kind of in the hundreds and even thousands, and a lot of young artists in there as well who are going to be kind of a lot more valuable in the future. So we got that, but then also for the kind of if you want something a little bit more premium as well, we do have these fantastic limited prints. So yeah, we've got Edmund's contributed that brilliant photo of the Peckham waiting room, which is a fantastic space if anyone, you know, Benedicto Luni Architects did that recently. It's great if you get the chance to visit. And then, any others that caught your eye?
The Hoshima Island by Andrew Meredith is great as well, because I just love derelict buildings as well. And once nature starts reclaiming them, that's really beautiful. Just a really hard choice, to be honest. You just have so much beautiful stuff here. The one by Will Scott is amazing. Just the scale of it, that gives a...
Oculus here.
Yeah, that's something that gives you an immediate feeling looking at that. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you can't decide, you know, you're welcome to buy all of them.
And, yeah, exactly.
Yes, you know, please support what you can. Or if you just got a few quids, you want to support with that. Because everyone that's contributed to this has done it for free. So if you've enjoyed it, you know, we have a little PayPal fundraiser on our supporters page if you just want to chip in, you know, your spare change. But I think the print sale is a really rare opportunity to get these fantastic pieces of art. And then, Emile, you're doing your own little initiative quite similar to this as well, aren't you?
Oh, yeah. I'm also selling my painting prints on helloemile.com. And yeah, like 50% of the sales are going to COVID response fund. So yeah, as well. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, I guess you just keep thinking like what can you do really in this time? How can you, as much as you can help really? And it's also part of the artist pledge, which is kind of helps all the, helps artists that are sort of like, you know, whose exhibition has been canceled or, you know, everything has been kind of postpone and they can't sell their art and stuff. And basically the idea is that once somebody buys enough prints from me, that's, you know, it comes up to £1,000, like after I donated, you know, to the fund, then I will buy somebody else's work, you know, and so on. And then that person, you know, once he reaches 1,000, he'll buy another artist. So it's kind of like just artists as well, like supporting each other. So yeah.
And I think that's kind of one of the silver linings that's come out of this crisis at the moment, is that maybe, you know, we're all so busy with our individual work, you know, especially kind of in our field where we're off on, you know, on site all the time, kind of doing these things by ourselves. It's actually given us a chance to come together, and there's been, you know, fantastic mutual support between artists. So yeah, thank you to everyone supporting this. I'm Luke O'Donovan, the director of Zoomed In Festival. We're at zoomedinfestival.com, at Zoomed In Festival on Instagram, at Zoomed Invest on Twitter. And Emile, where can we find you on the internet?
I'm just helloemile.com, or like on my Instagram, helloemile. Yeah. Thank you so much, Luke. This has been amazing. Thank you so much for asking. You guys are doing an amazing job. Like, I've been watching the talks, and yeah, hopefully like we can do it in person next year, or, you know, this works well too. But yeah, hopefully we can all have a beer soon anyway.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of photographers who I owe a pint, so I might be hiding away for a bit. thank you to everyone that's tuning on YouTube. Thank you to Emile for sharing your story. And 7 p.m., I will hopefully see a lot of you back with Laura. So take care and see you then.